As the first world raced to space in 1962, Defense Research and Development Canada were hard at work on satellites Alouette 1 and Alouette 2 to launch Canada onto the stage as the fourth country to operate a satellite and the third country to design and construct their own satellite in the world. My name is Chad Oman and welcome to Canadian Space. The ionosphere was of particular interest to Canadians due to navigators finding magnetic anomalies with their compasses around the Arctic Circle. Early experimentation with ground-based radio equipment found a relationship between solar activity and the ionosphere. The National Research Council of Canada was becoming a world leader in ionospheric research and was looking for new ways to understand the ionosphere's properties. This started with the early Black Brant sounding rockets. These sent scientific payloads into a suborbital trajectory, which helped unlock some of Earth's ionospheric secrets. The advent of the Russian Sputnik probe spurred a whole new opportunity for Canada to study the ionosphere from above instead of below. We'll talk more about Black Brant in a future video. Alouette 1 and Alouette 2, French for Skylarks, were a joint US-Canadian program to discover, from above, the secrets of Earth's ionosphere and what relationships it share with geographical location, season, and the time of day. It took a mere 3.5 years to develop and build Alouette 1, but they didn't build just one bird. Prototypes S27-2, S27-3, and S27-4 were assembled by Defense Research Telecommunications Establishment Electronics Lab, in Ottawa, Ontario, but we're going to call them DRTE for short. The frame of the satellite and its stem antennas, the storable tubular extendable mechanism, were built by Special Products and Applied Research Aerospace, SPAR Aerospace, a company who was the product of a management buyout of De Halavan Special Products Division and Avro Canada's Applied Research Unit. The stem antennas were flown aboard NASA's suborbital flight of the Freedom 7 capsule, making Alan Shepard the first American to travel in space in 1961. STEM was flown again in 1962 aboard NASA's Friendship 7 capsule, with John Glenn, the first American to orbit the Earth. It was also flown on most of the Apollo and Gemini missions, and we'll understand why they were a little later on. You've heard of De Halavan for airplanes like the DHC-1 Chipmunk and the DHC-8-8, but the history of De Halavan Aircraft of Canada dates back to 1928 in the Second World War. Avro Canada was also a Canadian aircraft manufacturing company founded in 1945 and grew to be the third largest company in Canada at the time. Avro had acquired PSC Applied Research Limited and renamed it Canadian Applied Research Limited in 1957. PSC, a flight navigation computer manufacturer, brought talented electronics engineers to Avro Canada. These engineers brought troves of knowledge and expertise to the government-sponsored Avro Aero aircraft program that Avro was proudly working on. Until it was cancelled just 1 year into production on Friday, February 20th, 1959, when Prime Minister John Diefenbaker announced immediate closure of the Aero program. It was announced that some 14,000 people lost their jobs overnight, and the company was ordered to destroy the 8 prototypes. Dennis McDermott, trade unionist with the United Auto Workers, and soon-to-be director of the UAW, was quoted to have said, "We will now lose the cream of our skilled aircraft technicians to the United States. History will prove this to be one of the most colossal blunders made by a prime minister in the history of Canada." And we did. This sent the company on a downward spiral, with many of the company's other engineers accepting jobs with Boeing, North American Aviation, Hughes, and McDonnell. More than 30 joined NASA and played key roles in the Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo programs. Those that held on with the company carried on through to SPAR. They are known as the developer of the Shuttle Remote Manipulator System, SRMS, or as it's best known, the Canada arm for NASA's Space Transfer System, best known as the Space Shuttle. Today, SPAR is part of MD Robotics after an acquisition in 1999, a subsidy of MDA Space Missions, who recently constructed the Canadian Space Agency's RADARSAT constellation and, of course, Canada Arm 2. But more on that in later videos. Okay, back to Alouette. The goal of the Alouette mission was to bring Canada into the space age and to study the ionosphere through the measurement of electron densities and flux at altitudes between 300 and 1,000 kilometers. Alouette 1 weighed 145 kilograms or 320 pounds at launch, and was made up of four scientific experiments: a sweep frequency sounder, energetic particle detectors, a very low frequency receiver, and two long radio antennas for detecting radio noise from the sun and the galaxy. The sounder was an experiment designed to measure the density of electrons in the ionosphere by measuring the time delay between transmitting and receiving a radio pulse. It was able to transmit pulses between the frequencies of 1 and 12 megahertz at a power of up to 100 watts. The particle detectors were really just an arrangement of Geiger counters for detecting particles. These experiments shared four stem antennas that were deployed at launch. They measured 45.7 meters and 22.8 meters in length. S27-3 was extensively tested under harsh G-force and vibrational conditions and proved to stand the abuse. It was transferred to the Goddard Space Flight Center in Washington, D.C. for acceptance by NASA. They tested the satellite in similar conditions and subsequently flew the satellite to Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. Alouette 1 was mated atop the Thor DM-21 Agena B rocket on a large spring to help propel the satellite away from the Agena B second stage upon orbit. Satellite S27-3 was launched as Alouette 1 by NASA aboard that Thor DM-21 Agena B rocket from the Pacific Missile Range at Vandenberg at 11.05 p.m. local Pacific Daylight Time on September 29, 1962, and was delivered to a nearly circular and nearly polar orbit between 987 kilometers and 1,022 kilometers at an 80.5 degree inclination. We can see Alouette 1's orbit in Celestrak and just how inclined its orbit is. Here now we can see just how important it was for Canada to work with international partners to get coverage over other parts of the world, because as Earth turns, Alouette 1 remains in a more or less static orbit. Interestingly enough, the satellite didn't have any way of storing the data it was receiving, and this in itself cultivated long-lasting relationships with international partners. It was important to be able to record data from Alouette 1 and eventually Alouette 2 at as many points in its orbit as possible. As a result, NASA and the United Kingdom aided the mission by providing support at ground stations and fed data back to the Prince Albert Radar Laboratory in, you guessed it, Prince Albert, Saskatchewan. This resulted in being able to record up to 6 hours of data from Alouette 1 and Alouette 2 via ground stations in Hawaii, Singapore, India, the UK, Norway, Australia, and Central Africa. Today, PARL consists of two antennas and acts as a central control hub for Natural Resource Canada's three ground stations, the other two being in Inuvik, Northwest Territories, and Gatineau, Quebec. There was also an 18-meter diameter antenna built at the Gatineau, Quebec ground station and stands today as a monument to the Alouette missions. More on these coming in a later video. After launch, the satellite was spin-stabilized to rotating at only 1.4 times per minute. About 500 days into the mission, the rotation had slowed down to about 0.6 rotations per minute, and at this point, the spin stabilization failed. Spin stabilization is accomplished by setting the satellite spinning and using the gyroscopic action of the rotating spacecraft mass as the stabilizing mechanism. This is really similar to how a yo-yo or a top stabilizes its orientation. Due to the failure, it was only then possible to determine Alouette 1's orientation via magnetometer readings and temperature readings from the upper and lower heat shields, and was really only accurate to within 10 degrees. Researchers speculate that the effects of gravity on the satellite caused the longest antenna to eventually point towards Earth. This still proved to provide good data for scientists, and the mission carried on. Meanwhile, satellite S27-4, Alouette 1's backup, was quickly modified and launched as Alouette 2 by NASA aboard a Thor SLV-2 Agena B rocket from the same Pacific Missile Range at 8:48 p.m. local Pacific Standard Time on November 29, 1965, to a similarly polar orbit, but a much more elliptical orbit of 508 kilometers and 2,652 kilometers at a 79.8 degree inclination. The idea was to extend the scope of the Alouette mission in both altitude coverage and the number of different ionospheric parameters being measured. But why did we have two flight-ready satellites to begin with? Well, the main reason is that early rockets were notoriously unreliable, and having two satellites ready would protect the mission from any launch anomalies that might happen. The difference between Alouette 1 and Alouette 2 was that Alouette 2 was fitted with five experiments on board. It also included a Langmuir probe experiment to measure the large ion sheath around the satellite caused by its long antennas. Modifications were also made to the antenna system to correct the spin rate decay that Alouette 1 suffered by adding reflective plates to the ends of the longer antennas. Alouette 1 carried on its mission for nearly 6 years before being deliberately switched off on September 30th, 1972, and to this day is still soaring high in our sky, having orbited nearly 86,000 times. The original mission was to only be a year long, and it was exceedingly successful in that to carry on for 6 times longer. It led to over 280 papers written on its data and proved to the world that Canada was ready to be a leader in the space age. It's quietly watched civilization develop into the technology age, and it's estimated to continue to fly for another 950 years until its orbit has decayed enough to make a fiery return back to Earth. Alouette 2 carried on and lasted 10 years and was switched off on August 1st, 1975. A data restoration effort was completed in the late 90s and successfully saved a great amount of the high-resolution data before the Canadian Space Agency discarded the telemetry tapes. This information is now available on the Canadian Open Government portal, where you can find hundreds of images with invaluable first looks at our planet's ionosphere. Through heartache and dismay of the Avro Arrow, the Alouette missions proved that Canadians are more than capable to contribute to the space industry and has since opened doors to innovate with the Canada Arm and other missions. Stay tuned for the rest of Season 1, where I'll talk about some of the other satellites Canada has contributed and what that's meant for innovation in Canada and abroad. Don't forget to follow Canadian Space on Twitter and at cdnspace.ca. There you'll find transcripts of our episodes and additional resources to continue your own exploration into Canadian space. If you like what we're doing here and want to contribute financially, head on over to our Patreon page at patreon.com/cdnspace. Thanks for watching and keep on exploring.